church occasion, this is a godly occasion. It has to do with a person that's going to be baptized and God and their relationship, their connection. So that's what it's all about, and you will hear that as we move forward. But great to see Pastor Steve King, who we just met today, and his wife, Glenn. Glenn, okay, sorry about that. And some of the other people from the church in, not Cornwall, but Long Sioux, and that's quite a journey to come here to support John. And that's what it's all about. That's what the Christian walk is all about. So thank you to you folks for coming to join us. And Mary and I, of course, my wife are heading back, not heading back, but we're moving to Newfoundland. And, Pastor Steve King and his wife just happen to be Newfie, so they know what it's all about. Going back to the rock. No, that just makes me think of that hymn, just rock up. Oh, no. Pastor's not here to help you. Anyway, you wouldn't want to hear me say that. Rock of ages, it was going to be. So, I just want to say thank you to our pastor, too, Pastor Glenn, for allowing me to be a part of this service. It's a great honor to be a part of it, and especially for, well, you know, the three men that are going to follow the Lord in baptism, and especially my brother Sean. It's just a great honor to be a part of his new walk, and you'll hear a little bit about his life and how God has changed it.
Amen.
And so with that, I really don't think there's anything else I have to open up with here. We're going to turn it over to the music team here, and he'll do a few numbers for us, and then we'll get into the procedures here. Thank you.
God happy right now? And we are going to give him the time of his name, because there is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain and bondage, every bag, every burden you carry. There is power in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Sing with me if you agree.
There is power.
music team, that was great worship music. I just think in the last part of that song there, he rescued me. He rescued me so I could stand and sing, so I could stand and share my testimony. And I'm thinking of a fellow in the Bible there. Jesus went on the other side of the ocean there. Not the ocean, but the lake, we'll call it. And it looks like a lake, but they don't call it a lake. Nonetheless, he went over there just for one person, and he done that for me. But when he got over there, he set the guy free. He was bound in sin, and I won't get into all the details about it, but nonetheless, he saved him and set him free, and the fellow wanted to follow Jesus. And you know what he told Jesus? Don't follow me. Just go into the town and tell him what good thing happened to you. So that's what a testimony is all about. It's not about me. It's not about Sean. It's not about Trent. Not about Gord. It's what God has done in our lives. So, tremendous. Thank you, David, once again. Good music. We're going to get into a couple other testimonies. These fellows aren't going to be following the Lord in baptism. They've already done that, but they're friends, people that we know, Sean and I, and they've got a story to tell. And it's always great to hear testimonies. I think they like this, like Jesus told us one guy, just don't tell them what happened. So Adam, I'm going to ask Adam if he would come up and join us. And just to let you know, Sean loves this guy. He's got a great story. God has done a great work in his life. So, Adam, God bless, brother.
Well, thank you.
Sorry about that.
No worries. All right, I'm honored for the privilege, and like you said, we're saved by the blood and our testimony. So any chance I get to share what God has done in my life, I'm eager to do that. I'll start just talking a little bit about where I've come from and how I've got to be on the stage today. So, my name is Adam. I'm 39 years old, and I grew up in a loving family. I was born in Burnaby, British Columbia. I had both parents and two sisters, one older and one younger. My older sister, Mandy, and my younger sister, Ashley. All five of us, we lived in a one-bedroom apartment in Burnaby. So we didn't have a lot, but we definitely had love. And with that, both of my parents grew up not having a lot. So they worked very hard to give us a life that they didn't have. They wanted us to enjoy things and things that they didn't have. And with that, we moved around a lot. We started off in the one-bedroom, and we slowly started getting better places, bigger places, and with that, moving around a lot, if anybody's experienced that, as a new kid, always trying to fit in, you know, trying to carve out an identity. I used to get into a lot of trouble and fights and try to make a name for myself everywhere I went. By high school, that progressed even worse. You know, that led me to drugs and partying and really just going astray. My older sister, Mandy, she got invited into some youth groups. So she started going to youth groups. She kind of developed this relationship with God. But she'd invite us all the time. But to be honest with you, I chose a different path. And I chose to party and use drugs instead. And my younger sister, Ashley, she did the same. My younger sister, Ashley, and me were very close. Because we shared this similar lifestyle, we'd help each other use and find drugs, and you know, we really trusted each other. She was my best friend. She was my ride or die. You know, like we knew each other and we trusted each other. I found school difficult, but because of the way my parents were brought up, you know, they didn't allow us to make excuses and they didn't tolerate laziness. So even though I found it difficult, I persevered through and I got through it. After high school, I went on to do some pretty great things. I landed a great job where I traveled around the world and I made lots of money. But you know, that led me down another path where I began to base my self-worth on possessions and achievements and what other people thought of me. You know, I never knew who I truly was. I chased the things that this world said would bring me happiness, would bring me joy, but I've come to learn the hard way that that is an empty existence. You know, I believe now we are born with this God-sized hole that nothing else will fill. And I tried to fill it with everything else. Believe me, I tried. At the age of 25, God blessed me with a son. My son Eric, who's here. But God blessed me with a son. And I thought I could force myself into responsibility. I was making good money. I had this job. Now I have a son. Okay, I'll buy a house and I'll just do what the world does, right? That's how you do it. But it wasn't so for me, and it was around that time that I began to use opiates. Prior to that, I'd always kind of partied and used drugs and lived that lifestyle, but opiates was a newfound drug for me that quickly grabbed a hold of me, and I developed a physical dependency. My life just turned into an unmanageable mess. You know, I had to have it, and I put it before everything else. If I didn't have them, I would be sick, and so all my money, all my time went into finding and getting them. The worst part about this was I missed out on being a brother, a son, and a father to my son. You know, it just consumed my life. And my life became unmanageable. I started with the partying and then went to the physical dependency. And slowly but surely, I began to use drugs to punish myself. I began to try to escape the feelings of pain and inadequacy. I didn't like the person I'd become. I knew I was capable of more, but I wasn't living it. And I found that drugs was my only way to escape, and my life just went worse and worse and worse. Eventually, addiction robbed everything from me. It robbed my relationships, my possessions, everything. My ability to trust myself, my ability to trust others. Everything was taken away from me. And by the end, I was a homeless, intravenous drug addict. I did what I had to do to get my next fix. I look back at this time in my life and I say I wasn't even living. I was just existing. I was a zombie. I knew nothing, and life was really hopeless. I was scared. Anyone who's been down that road, I started to experience drug-induced psychoses. I'm an intelligent guy, but at that point in my life, my mental health, my physical health, everything was deteriorating. To be honest with you, I felt like I was being tormented by demons. I heard and seen things and witnessed things that I don't even like to think about. It was around that time that I cried out to God. I didn't know God, to be honest with you. I didn't know. My older sister had taken me to church a couple of times. I used to go to play basketball, but I didn't know. But I knew that there had to be something. I knew that I had met evil, and if evil exists, there had to be good. Got down on my hands and knees and I cried out. And I said, God, I know that you can get me out of this. If you save me, I'll fight for you. I don't want to go down this road I'm going. Please. Shortly after that, I was evicted from the place I was staying. So I was homeless. I went by my parents' house. It was, I think it was January, or it was cold out. And I had nowhere to go. So I thought, okay, I go to mom and dad's, just try to get a warm meal and warm up for a bit. And that relationship had been so strained. I'd lied to them and stuff so many times that they didn't want me around. But I got there, and my older sister, Mandy, was there, the one who had gone to church. And I remember her telling me, she said, Adam, God told me to come here today. I didn't know what I was here to do, but now that I see you, you know, I see that there's a reason for me being here. So she said I could stay at her house. She said, you could stay here, you could crash on the couch, as long as you continue to try and get help. You try and get into rehab. So she helped me line up a rehab and line things up. She helped me get to doctor's appointments and doing the things I had to do. I had a plan. Everything was working out. The date came when I was supposed to go into a detox facility prior to going to rehab. We were just getting on the 401,
And the detox facility called and said, we can't take you. We can't take you based on the amount of the high dose of drugs you're on. We're not physically equipped or medically equipped to take the withdrawal that you're going to experience. I was ready to give up. You know, I told my sister, I said, just drop me off. I'll figure something out. Don't worry about it. We tried, you know. But now my sister, she locked the doors, got on the 401, and she started praying.
Amen.
She said, Adam, God's got a plan. He's got a plan. He didn't bring you this far. She just kept praying. So I started calling every detox in Ontario. Full. I'd get numbers from one, and they'd give me the number to the next one. And finally, I got the number to one in London, the Salvation Army. She said, we got a bed available, but you got to come right now. I said, okay, I'm on my way. What's your name so I can tell them when I get there? Her name was Faith. What are the chances, right? I, in my mind at that time, thought, okay, it's a coincidence, right? But my sister knew, so we got there. I got there, and Faith's dad actually helped found Teen Challenge London, which is the rehab I went into. So Faith began to show me Bible verses and stuff. But in the first 4 days of detox, based on what I was coming off of, you're bound to get sick. Your body's getting rid of the toxins. You know, I've been through it before, and I got terribly sick before. So they hold you in an observation room. So I'm in this observation room. I believe the set is 4 days. But I was honest with them with what I was coming off of, and they held me for 5 days. I didn't really get that sick, you know? Fifth day, and I'm thinking, it's coming. Fifth day, they said, well, we don't know what to say. You can come out. So I called my older sister to thank her again for the ride. I said, thank you so much for getting me here. Everything's going well. I didn't even get that sick. You know what she said? She wasn't even surprised. She said, Adam, I've been praying and fasting for you. I knew you'd be okay. And it was at that moment, something just clicked. I said, okay, I want to know this God. I want to know this God that just brought me through this, right? I remember getting off the phone with her and going back to my room, and I'll never forget the feeling I felt. I said, okay, God, I'm all in. I'm all in, but I know where my way was going. It wasn't working. I'll take whatever you got. I'm all in. And I felt it in my heart. Just something warm just came over me, and I'll never forget it. Like, it even makes me emotional just thinking about it. But he answered, and I could see my perspective started to shift in life. I remember running around the detox center and thanking all the people that worked there. You know, here's these people for minimum wage that are just there to help people, just to love people. And I couldn't fathom that. Coming from where I come from, everything was based on how much can I get, what can I get, you know? And to see these people just selflessly giving everything, you know, just to help others. And so I came from the detox facility and entered Teen Challenge. Now, for those of you that don't know, Teen Challenge is a one-year rehab/discipleship program. Very strict, and but very in the Word. All the people that work there are volunteers. You know, like they just want to share God's love with you. So that atmosphere combined with you know, my hunger to know this newfound God, I was in the Word all day, every day. I wanted to know who this was and how this worked, and you know, I wanted answers. And I'm telling you, reading those scriptures, it came alive. I felt like God was speaking directly to me. I can't even begin to explain the revelations I had, the things that happened, you know. It just continued to grow spiritually and understand who God was. And I wish that I could just end it all on a high note, but I developed this amazing relationship with God, and I needed it more than ever, as in that program while I was there, my younger sister Ashley, that I told you about, she passed away of a drug overdose. So she didn't make it, as many don't, you know? And I don't know how I would have been able to handle that before. You know, I was devastated, but God gave me strength. And that's our God. He has a way of taking that pain, and turning it into something, you know? And so I graduated Teen Challenge, and I said, I'm going to make it my mission. My sister was one of the most beautiful people you'd ever meet. Greatest heart. And I know that there's so many like that still stuck out there, just stuck. Good people that are stuck. And I said, okay, God, I'm fighting for you. And so since graduating, I've done, you know, God keeps bringing these amazing people into my life. I run an online ministry where I help other addicts that are struggling, support them. We raise money to get them into rehabs. You know, I just want to do anything I can. I want to give back for all the years that I'd selfishly taken. If I could sum it up, I heard the other day in a testimony where the guy said God had gave him the freedom to be the man he was created to be. And that really resonated with me, you know? Freedom from guilt, freedom from shame, freedom from living up to a reputation, freedom from what this world deems as popular or cool, or, you know, just freedom from all of it. I'm overjoyed with the feelings I have now, and yes. And God continues to restore me. And to be honest, I've never seen that more evident than I have in Sean's life. I didn't know Sean prior to knowing Christ and his transformation, but I have heard a lot of stories, I'll be honest. But nowadays, I hear a lot of stories too. And they're stories of what a kind, compassionate, and great human being you are, man. And I'm just honored and blessed, and thank you to be here. Thank you, guys.
Give us some direction. So each of us had, there was only 16 of us in the family. And so each of us had to find our own way in life. And mine was down that road of drugs, alcohol, fighting. And I had a great job. I worked at Chrysler Trim Plant. I lost it 7 times, my job there. And they didn't want me. Nobody really wanted me. Nobody wanted me around. And lost my license. 4 times for impaired driving, and just that kind of lifestyle. Not a lot of time in jail. Spent a couple times in the bucket, they call it, but not in prison. But life was hard. It was just devastating. My inner being cried so many times to get out of the life I was living. Hard to do. Hard to do. You know, you can change some things in your life, but you just can't. The inner struggle is where it was at. So anyway, just to move forward with that, I'm at work one day. I'd just come back to work. I was off for 7 months. They fired me. The union fought for me. And 7 months later, I end up coming back. Now, they didn't have a job for me, so whenever somebody was off, I would fill in for them in certain areas. And it just so happened, this one woman that I had to work with, she was a Christian woman. So I'm working, she's talking to me about God and Jesus Christ, and I'm thinking, who is this girl? I never heard anything. But what attracted me was she was beautiful, not necessarily just beautiful to look at, but a beautiful heart. She meant it. When she was talking to me, she meant it. And that never really happened with me. And I listened to her, and she really spoke to my heart. But here's the big thing about it. The day was over, the shift was over. And she said, "Brian, you're not going to believe this, but we've been praying for you." "Praying for me? What? Somebody pray for me?" Yeah, I didn't really know what prayer was about, but, you know, to hear somebody say that they're praying for you, her and the church that she was going to. And not only that, she had already been prepared. God had put on her heart to get a book for me, and it was called The Cross and the Switchblade. So God was in it. He had already prepared her to speak to me and set this whole work and relationship up. So I wasn't going to read the book. I did take it. I wasn't going to read it. I'm living on my own. That was tough, too. I didn't like that too much. But just a lost soul. Anyway, I did read the book. I started reading it, and it just seemed like 5 minutes I was finished the book. And then I started crying. I don't know why I was crying, but I cried. And it was a good, made me feel good. It was a good cry. The tears were just pouring out. But I couldn't wait to go back to see Claire, the one that gave me the book, and tell her that I read it. And boy, can I get another, is there another book? I thought it was the book that made me feel good. So she said, you know, the disappointment, he didn't write another book. But here's the part here. Here's God's hand in it. He didn't write the book. Now, David Wilkerson has never been in Canada before. That night, he's speaking in Oshawa, just around the corner from where Brian lives. He came all the way to Oshawa for Brian. All set up for me. So I went to the auditorium, the Civic Auditorium, nervous as could be. Thousands of people there. And when I went in, he said, "Oh, the place is full. Let me get you a seat." He got me a fold-up seat and set me in the aisle. And right at the back. And so David Wilkerson was just coming out and started speaking. I had never heard anybody speak about God or the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ dying for our sins and that kind of stuff. And you must be born again. So, but every time he spoke, he went like that. He was a mile away from me, seeing way up there. When he went like that, his finger seemed like it was touching my nose. It was so real that I thought he's just, and it looked like he was just looking at thousands of people. He's just looking at me. Claire must have told him about me. So anyway, he made an altar call, and he said, but it was just me. He said, "I want you to come up." It wasn't just me, but it seemed like it was just me. Here's his finger on my nose again. "I want you to come up here now. God's talking to you." And you know, I fought it. Did I ever fight it? But I ended up going up. And I see these other people coming up. I have the long hair and the beard, and I'm walking up there, just a little guy. But anyway, there was some fear there. When I went up there, I see these other people coming up. I think, they must think I'm going to do something to him. They're surrounding me. And so I get up there, and here again is all, you know, a large number of people coming up there for the same altar call. I didn't know that. And so David Wilkerson is looking down. I think, okay, he's talking to me again. I want you to say this prayer. And so I bowed my head and we prayed. And as soon as I started praying, something happened. I just, all of a sudden, I felt something, a heavy weight or demons or something leaving me. And a weight of freedom, like you wouldn't believe. So I lift my head up. We finished praying, I lift my head up and thought, "Whoa, who turned all these lights on?" It looked like the place had lit up. And I felt so, right instantly, a different mindset, a different feeling. And he said, "I want you to go turn around and walk down that aisle." I was talking to everybody again, but here I go. I go down there and come back up, and he sends me down again. And I don't know what that was all about, but it was fun going down. But nonetheless, I get to work the next day, and some people at work, even in my appearance, my facial appearance, they thought they weren't even sure who I was. I had changed that much, and just that transformation right there. And God has done a miraculous work in my life. He's a life-giving Savior. You know, that's what it's all about. He came to seek and to save us. Pastor Mark now, but he's got a story. recently, a beautiful man, a man of God, and we're just going to hear what how God has ministered and transformed his life. You want to do that?
Yeah.
Amen. Okay, we're just going to have a word of prayer. Father, we just say thank you for your saving grace.
Yes.
For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift from you. And we thank you for that. We pray for Mark as he shares his story, his testimony, that you will use him in a mighty way. In Jesus' name.
Hello.
Hello.
Well, I like to keep it on because now it's not against the law for me to wear one. Another class 4 federal charge if you don't have a handgun. I left mine on the bike. No, I'm joking. My name is Mark. I'm a grateful believer in Jesus Christ. I'm humbly here to see a brother get baptized that came from a life that I did myself. I'll go through it nice and easy. When I was a child, I was brought up in a mob family. My grandfather's had a Polish mob. We got pictures of my grandfather and Al Capone together. I wasn't taught about God. We didn't do the Lord's Prayer. We didn't go to church. What we learned was how to... It's up to you to make what you have. You fight for everything, right? And before that somebody can do something to you, you do it to them first and make sure you do it hard and strong. So they never think about coming back at you. And by the way, Brian, you know why you scrapped a lot, right? Because you're a Campbell. Sean gets it. And so I was brought up in this life. We had everything we needed. You know, we weren't poor, but we lived a certain life. Now I need to say something that a lot of men won't talk about, but when I was 8 years old, I was violently raped and left for dead. And then after that, my father taught me how to fight every single day, because my father felt like he let me down, and there's only one way he could make it better was by teaching me to be a very strong, tough man. Well, at 8 years old, not very tough. You're not very strong. When something like that happens to you, you don't know which way is up in there. So the beatings, they call them beatings. It gets grasped with the old man. And at 13 years old, he beat me to a point of where my orbital bone broke and my eye fell out. And I was hiding underneath the wood pile. I remember the Lord's Prayer in school. You know, I'm that age where it was the Lord's Prayer. It was God save the Queen and oh Canada, right? There's my age right there. God save the Queen. And I sat there and I go, if there is a God, take me from here. And he didn't. So I decided right there I would hate him as much as he. From that time on, I lived in the streets of Toronto at 13 years old. I still stayed in school. I knew that if I didn't stay in school, I would become something. And I worked hard at everything I could. I was taken in to a boxing club downtown Toronto, Cabbage Town. Taught me how to box. I did the martial arts. Got pretty good at it. And then there was a couple of guys that used to ride motorcycles around the neighborhood. And I started hanging out with them. And one of the crazy things, I call it a coincidence, one of my mentors was Campbell's cousin, Lorne. And he was my mentor in the club, one of them that taught me things. And I learned as a youngster that to sit back and listen to my elders. I learned a lot. Instead of chirping, instead of yapping, I listened. Well, in that time, I started riding for a motorcycle club, doesn't matter which one. I've been shot, I've been stabbed, I've done time. All my time was provincial, it wasn't club fed. It was the Don Jail, called Gladiator School. And I've done a couple of years in there, in and out. They used to have the address book from Salvation Army, and you'd got a Bible, right? I always took the Bible, because it rolled really good joints. Right? It would never canoe. So, if you think about it, God was getting his word in me, right? So, at 42, I met a woman I fell in love with. And she was brought up United Pentecostal. I had no clue what that meant. I guess it was a coincidence. At 44, she gave birth to my beautiful son November 1st. I was hoping for October 31st. But she held on to November 1st, which is, I found out later on, it's All Saints Day. It must be another coincidence. My son's second birthday, at 44, I used to own a bar downtown, and I had to go talk to a guy for about 4 hours with a taser and a rope. 2 a.m., my son's birthday, the cost of the fancy pants came through the door. That's DGF for people that don't know. And this helicopter over top, and I'm going away, and I'm going away for a long time. So, December 8th, in the dawn, I got into a little scuffle on the range, and I got stabbed 5 times in the head. And I was at St. Mike's for a couple of days, and they didn't know if I was going to make it or not. And I did, because I've got a super thick skull, that's why it takes me so much to learn. And when I came back to the dawn, it was December 25th, I'm in SAG, because the guy that stabbed me didn't make it. So I had an additional charge. So December 25th, it was the Salvation Army at Sunshine Bank. And they do it on that day in the dawn, for some reason. And I remember I was up in SAG, which is segregation, I was by myself. And I had to go against the back wall when they came to the gate. And I remember the guard saying, don't worry about that. Keep on going. And he threw a sunshine bag in, which had cookies and a Kit Kat. I was happy. But he threw a Bible in too, and the Bible hit the ground and the envelope open. And of course, I went for the pink greens first because, you know, and then I picked up the Bible, and it was enveloped open to Psalm 51. And there was 2 parts of it. And it was a broken and contrite heart, and another part was, I will praise you when the bones of your broken men. Didn't know what it meant. For some reason, it sat in me. You know, it sat in my heart, it sat in my gut. And I thought, okay, you know what, I got to change my life. I have a 2-year-old son. If I ever get out of here, I got to be a father. Not going to be like my family was. I got to stop this nonsense. So I don't want my son there. So I gave myself to the Lord in that cell, whichever way I thought was possible. And then the guard said to me a couple hours later, he goes, you gave yourself to God? I went, yeah. He goes, cool. He goes, okay, you got to go to court when it opens back up again, because they had videotape of what happened in the range. And there was no evidence. There was no nothing. I could jump away. 14 guys, and so that charge was dropped. Must have been a coincidence. It was, I guess, about 2 weeks after that, I got changed down to a general pop range again. And my cellie was a guy I knew from the old days. He was a good earner, and he found God. He did 9 years in club fed, which is, you know, no whirlpools, just iron, and Sean likes that. And then he told me about God, because he saw me reading the answer book, which is a little red book. And he goes, you want to know about that? I go, sure. So he started teaching me that. And then he said, they were at a place called Teen Challenge. Like, no, I don't have a clue. He goes, well, they get to work on motorcycles and cars and stuff. So as a guy that likes to wrench motorcycles and cars, it kind of caught my ear. And I'm not getting bail, so I don't know how to get to this place, right? But then I was accepted in the Teen Challenge, and then I went to high court, and I caught bail. And the only stipulation was I wasn't allowed into GTA, which is cool because it was in London. So I went to Teen Challenge, and I went Easter weekend. It's a guy that's never been to a church. We've been to church, but that's a meeting. Never been into a church. This is Easter weekend. I went to 6 churches. No, both of them were Pentecostal. You know what I mean? I wasn't drinking the Kool-Aid. I was a little freaked out, a little scared. And then after a while, I'd say 10 months of discipline, I was on there. I got into a lot of trouble. You know, I felt things out. And my discipline was for Adam and those guys, it was digging ditches. Mine was to read the Bible in Hebrew and Greek. 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. I learned that Bible in and out. Now, did I live it? It was transforming me. Right? I didn't live it. I didn't vomit religion. I tried to act it out. Right? And that's what, as men, that's what we're called to do. And when I graduated from there, the wife said, you're not coming home. You have full right to do that. Because I'm the one that did this. I'm the one that put me here, not you. I accepted that, and accepted it humbly. Well, I got a job in London, and I couldn't get a job anywhere. I'm an organized crime charges, you know, it's not a good situation. And I got a job putting alarm systems in hotels and banks. Okay? Come on, God's got a sense of humor. Crazy, isn't it? Well, 6 months went by, and the wife finally said, I want you to come home and be a dad, not a husband, dad. And, that right there was just a blessing. I came home. What I didn't know is my mother-in-law moved into our house in Pickford. My mother was old school, you know, the part of the Bible where it says Paul had a thorn in his side? I had a tree. Right in there. So 3 years go by, and you know what? God bless her. And because I needed it. Right? Because I came out of there with some, I call it educational pride. I knew about the Bible pretty good, right? And she was a Christian since she was 12. And I was like, that's not what that scripture means. What's wrong with you? You know? So I was taught the sermon. And I tell you, my head's pretty thick. Eh? God hit me in the face a couple times with the shovel for me to learn what I do. I was accepted in the Tyndale. And then I did a test and everything else. And I just finished my master's. And I went to U of T and I got my psychology degree and my addictions degree. And this isn't me. It's all God. It had nothing to do with me. I'm an idiot. Right? 47 years I was an idiot. So, and that's when I found God at 47. You know, it doesn't matter how old you are. When he picks you, he picks you, boy, and there's no getting away from it, you know?
Yeah.
So now, I'm blessed to have what we have here, to have this family, to have a complete stranger. I got a trailer at Buckhorn, and I was sitting there, I shared a boat slip with a guy, and And the guy's looking at me, he goes, are you Mark Carlos from Teen Challenge? I just went, oh, crap. And I go, yeah. And he goes, man, it's so good to meet you. And I go, really? Buckhorn in the trailer beside me? What's going on? So God's got a great sense of humor again, right? So now I find, when I say coincidences, I find coincidences, they're all God's divine appointments.
Amen.
Right? I like to use the coincidence word because there's a lot of people that don't realize that everything that happens is God's divine appointment.
Yeah.
Right? I had Sean call me and ask me, we'll talk about the Bible. I was like, really? Aren't you a biker? You're a nasty one too. He's the kind of a fella we walked into in the bar in the old days, we'd be lifting up shirts, but we show that we have nothing on us. You know what I mean? Otherwise, it's going to be a blazing gunfight, you know? Which, yeah, we didn't mind at the time. But, again, this is all God. Right? I am so honored and so blessed to watch my brother say it publicly how much he loves Christ. And to see his wife and his daughter here, come on, you know? Thanks, guys.
Sean doesn't even know the difference. But anyway, he stopped everything. He said, hey, we've got somebody new here. And when come down out from the pulpit, hugged Sean, shook his hand, got to know Karen, and just introduced him right away to the congregation. That is how it's done. And of great importance. But not only that, one step further, and I love this part too, is the next day, Pastor Steve and his wife had Sean and Karen over to their house and spent 3 and 4 hours, talking and sharing. You know, there's nothing greater to a new believer, especially one that comes from our lifestyle, to be taken in like that, to be accepted, to be a part of. And not only that, but the congregation also, those that are here to support Sean, kudos, because this is what it's all about. We're brothers and sisters in the Lord now, and it doesn't get any stronger, and the strength comes from each one of us. So good for you guys. Appreciate that. Pastor Glenn's going to speak a little bit on what is baptism, what's the purpose of it as far as a believer goes.
All right, thank you. Thank you for coming again. And, it was 41 years ago that we were in college together. 41, I've heard the name. I Zoom with him almost every week in Pastor's prayer. In
10 years, is that? 10?
Yeah, I think so. We looked a lot different back then. But what a way the way the Lord orchestrates things. I just want to say something very quickly. A lot of mess is made in our world regarding religion. You know, if the enemy can't oppose you directly, then become like them, but get people confused and sick and tired. And that's what religion is. Religion has done a lot of damage in this world.
Yes, yeah.
You're a pastor, you're religious. I'm not religious. I'm not religious. I just believe in the Word of God.
Amen.
It's changed my life. You know, I've never been drunk in my life. I've never toked once. A few people would make fun of me, my friends, and said, you know, you're a religious goody two-shoes and you're better than us. And because I didn't do those things. And I would get so sick and tired of that, I'd grab their beer wine and just go like this, and there, are you happy now? Ooh, you're going to hell. And I said, well, I'm not, you know. That's what religion does. It freaks people out, it messes things up, it exaggerates, it blows it out of proportion.
Yeah.
None of us are religious here. If you're here and you're not a Christian, forget religion.
Yeah.
Get out of the churches that are religious. There's religious churches in every town.
Yeah.
Don't become a part of them.
Yeah.
They're full of assimilating to this world. They're full of progressive Christianity. They're making a mess of the true Word of God.
Amen.
Baptism. A lot of people are baptized as a child, and they're sprinkled. They have no idea what it was all about, and that's going to be some of the testimonies. I'm not going to steal your thunder here, Gordon. But baptism in the Word of God, and I remember we had to study Greek and Hebrew. I was terrible at that. Kudos to you. But you know, but if you study the real Word of God and the root of it all, you realize baptism is full immersion. And you realize every person in the Bible was baptized, was an adult. You made a decision for yourself. It wasn't your parents for you. So when we do baptism, we just do full immersion. That's what we do according to the Word of God. Not making a big mountain out of this. If you want, what about water baptism? We have pamphlets there. Take it, pass it around to other religious people you know, and they'll tell you, or they'll read what it is. There's all different points here, and I want everybody to take it home so that you understand what this water baptism is about. Steve,
I'm not sure what you're supposed to do.
I'm taking it over. I really want to say something about John, or, you know,
you're his... Those who know me know I'm going to say something.
Can I say something before you start? Can I leave it with you? About 6 months ago, I'm in my office. It was a Thursday afternoon. I didn't know Sean was in town. Brian had told me about his big brother, Sean, and I only knew you by a name, but with the Hells Angels, and not just the Hells Angels, but the Nomads. What's the Nomads? Well, you want. So he told me the whole story. I was like, wow. I hear he comes to Christ. He's here. I'm sitting in my office with a young guy who is demonically possessed. I'm telling you, you could see it in his eyes. He freaked out on me. I thought he was going to attack me. And so I called Brian and I said, Brian, I need support. Get down here. Brian shows up with his brother, Sean. This guy, and I didn't know Sean was coming, but this guy was talking numbers that had to do with the Hell's Angels and all that. I don't know that. Street names of drugs. So Sean shows up and I go, glory, hallelujah. Sean, talk to this guy. So they sat there and talked. And they were throwing out names and numbers of stuff, and I had no idea. I was lost. And then we left from there. 72 hours later, he stabbed a police officer 3 times in the neck. He's in prison right now. We're trying to work with him. Sean might be working along with him too. But just the way the Lord orchestrates things. And some of your testimonies, you come out of these stories, share your testimony. It's a great weapon against the enemy that works against us.
I want to let you know he's now my bodyguard. I spoke on water baptism this morning. I don't know. I know how I'm going to get him down. But getting him up is the issue. But big things do float, okay? So maybe he'll float to the surface. If not, Carl, I might need your help. I haven't lost one yet, Sean. I thank you, Brian, for sharing what God did at our church. You know, this what God did at our church. is not about us, it's about God. I'm born like your pastor into a preacher's home. My story is quite different than yours. I was in church before I was born. Do you understand that? I was in church probably within 1 week of conception. Yeah, that's right. Mama brought me to church before I was born. And it's like this Jeremiah. And but Sean, my father is 90 years old now, 90 and a half, really. I'm going to go home to visit him in 3 weeks from today. And I can't wait to see him. He's a preacher. He's been a pastor since in his 20s. But so he's been a Christian since he was 18 years of age. Do the math. And for you that can't do the math, that's 72 years. Okay? Sean, 7 months. I said it this morning, you're just as much a child of God as my father, who's been yes. a minister and a Christian for 72 years. Your story is no different from my wife's. 8 years of age, God saved her. He saved you. Doesn't matter where your life was. Amen. Thank God, He's still the Savior. Amen? Amen? And I'm looking forward to dropping you in the water, and I hope you come up. Some people, like I said this morning, need to stay a little bit longer. So if you're down a little while, God will bless you. God.
So two of them from here are going to give their testimony first and then follow the Lord in the waters of baptism. And then Sean will also be baptized. And then when he's baptized, he's going to come out and share his testimony. He felt like he'd rather be baptized first and then come out and share. And that's all right. There's no protocol concerning that. So I'm going to ask Gord Conassy. I'm not sure where Gord is, if he would come up and share his testimony. And then we will have, I will come back up and call Trent up, and he'll share his, and then they will go into the waters of baptism from there.
Expecting this many people. And for the record, I've been on a motorcycle once. My testimony is I was brought up in a church called home. It was the early 1970s, and back then, world. Different place. When a family moved into town, if they didn't go to church, tongues would cluck. That family doesn't go to church. Now it's the reverse. Now you move and those guys go to church. grew up in a little town. First place I really remember is New Jersey. Church we went to, Community Church of Glen Rock, when you were in grade 3, 1974, they gave you your first Bible. And that was special. As you can see, it's seen better days. It's kind of emblematic of myself. Rough around the edges too. But Christ told you to get it. Anyway, so I was going to Bible camps, Bible study, was in the church choir. Life was good. Then we started moving around a bit. Moved from when I was in grade 4, we moved to Burlington, Ontario. Went to a church there. Then we moved to Portland, Oregon when I was in grade 6, went to a different church there. Then we moved to Pickering, Ontario, went to a different church again, and I lost that connection. And started drifting away. And then I was, when I was 15, I took a job at McDonald's. And there was a youth pastor by the name of Warren who used to come into McDonald's. And he would come in with his Bible. He'd order some food. He'd go and sit in the smoking section. And he would engage anyone who came to say he'd talk to anybody. And he and I started talking. And I knew these words were true. And he got me to ask Jesus into my heart. And I started going to the Christian Life Center in Ajax. And that was a bit of a shock for me because I'd been brought up in more the United Church, the Reformed Church of America, Church of Christ in Oregon. It wasn't, Pentecostal wasn't what I was used to. I remember sitting in church and hearing people shout out, and I was like, shh, the reverend's talking. So it was a bit of a different experience, but I enjoyed the youth groups and went to a Bible camp when I was 17. But the lures of the world are strong. The enemy is always at work, pulling your way. And I walked away from my faith. I was a good person. I knew, do unto others. I wasn't stealing or doing anything bad. I was a good person. And when I turned 40, God came looking for me. The good shepherd. And bring me back. We all know the parable of the sower and the seeds. I was on rocky ground and it didn't take root. I needed more manure. And I got the manure. My marriage failed. 2 kids. Then my mother contracted cancer. And during my wanderings, I still went to church on occasion. I could fake it with the best of them. I liked the hymns. And I'd gotten to know a pastor, and he, as my mom had been diagnosed with cancer, he came back into my life and he said, Gordy, come back to church. I'm pastoring a church in Oshawa. Come. So I started going and I started hearing the word. And the more I got into it, the more I had so much anger. And it took the anger away. Because anger is a dangerous emotion. You spiral down, and God lifted me up. At the advanced age of 43, I went into basic training and I joined the Army. And Scott, that's the name of my friend who's the pastor, he said, keep going to church. Keep hearing the word. So they had chapel every Sunday. I would go every Sunday. The great thing was you never knew what you were going to get. One Army chaplains can be Catholic, Anglican, Missionary Alliance, Pentecostal, United, whatever. Didn't matter. Pour it into me. Give me the word. And eventually I found myself here in Brighton. And I'd always been brought up in the United Church. Living in Canada, so I started going to the United Church here in town. It was about that time I got to know Glenn and his wife Carrie at the local tennis club. And I've always loved gospel music, and one day, having heard that Carrie plays the piano and, you know, does music here, I started to tell her about a song that I really like, and it's that one, We Are Walking in the Light of God. And Glenn heard me just singing a few bars, and Glenn came over to me and he said, how do you know that song? And I said, Glenn, I was now going to church every Sunday. I said, I go to church every Sunday. I love gospel music. And he said, you have to come to my church. And I looked at Glenn and I said, Glenn, I can be a pretty lousy Christian. And in testament to that fact is I didn't use the word lousy. And Glenn smiled his big toothy grin and he said, we take those. So when all this madness started 16 plus months ago, I was going to the United Church for about 2 years, a year and a half. And I always felt like I was at an all-you-can-eat buffet, but that they were closing the trays on me. I wasn't getting enough. And I remember I spoke to a chaplain, an army chaplain who I dealt with, and I started going to a different church here in town. And got a lot more. I felt satisfied, but I felt, leaving the United Church wasn't easy. And this woman, Mary Ellen, she said to me, you have to go where your soul is being fed. And when all this madness started, I don't like online church. It's like trying to draw heat from that fireplace, fire log at Christmas time. I believe we are called to be in community. And the first pastor in this town to open his church to corporate worship is Glenn. Meeting out on the lawn. And Sistine Chapel here, no ceiling in any church ever looked better than God's gorgeous sky. Amen. And it was just, again, lifting me up. Being back in community. Hearing God's word. But then we moved back in, so that was in May, and then August, September, we started doing, the church started to come back inside, and that's when Glenn did a service on baptism, and after the service, he saw me outside, and he said, Gord, have you been baptized? And I looked at him and said, well, I've been sprinkled. And all he said, he just said, think about it. And when someone tells me to think about it, especially a pastor, especially, a faith leader, okay, I'm going to think about it. So I thought about it. I didn't have to think about it because all of a sudden I watched an online video that night that was about baptism. And I listened to a sermon about the Ethiopian eunuch. And I'm going, this bang, bang, bang. So I called Glenn up and went out for a coffee at Tim's. He gave me probably what is the same pamphlet you have there. And I'm like, it's all right there. And I kind of chose to wear black today because I was thinking of, there's a baseball player named Yogi Berra who's famous for butchering the English language. And he once said, you should go to everyone's funeral because if you don't go to theirs, they won't come to yours. And in a fashion, I started thinking this week that baptism, to a degree, you're dying to your old self. And I've already done that. But it's a relationship. And it's one more step closer in that relationship. And anyway, that's my testimony.
People do that. You do it just, it's just an automatic thing to do that. I know even at work after I got saved, well, there's no doubt about it that people spoke and said that I needed, and I did need it. But little did people know that we're all lost and we're all sinners. Amen. And when Christ went to the cross, he went to the cross for all of us. Amen. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So the only entrance, thinking about that, the only entrance into heaven is not how good you are, but your relationship with Christ is of utmost importance. So, you know, I just wanted to put that out there because, you know, we're hearing some testimonies of places where we went that are deep. But, you know, God came not to call the righteous, but sinners unto repentance. And when he talks about righteousness there, he's talking about self-righteous people. You know, we can easily be self-righteous by looking at somebody else, judging ourselves according to their lifestyles. But that's not going to cut it. In the end, we're all looking for a hope. Where is our life going to end up? And there's two choices Pastor spoke on this morning. Pretty bold, so he's going to give me the opportunity to say the same thing. You're either going to end up in heaven or in hell. That's the way it is. So our next speaker is going to be Trent Hunter, and another military man. Great testimony, great man of God, and looking forward to hearing.
Pastor Glenn, Pastor Dave, Pastor Steve, visiting to come in to do the baptism for Sean. Thank you all for the efforts you put into it, because really this is a big gathering and it's a lot of work that went into it. I would also like to thank my immediate family members that have come up. My loving wife Kathleen is here with me today to support me. My beautiful daughter Amanda is also here to witness this and be with me to support me. My brother-in-law Scott, and then another fantastic individual that I just met in person for the today, Jeff Cottom is here. He was a team leader for a discipleship course I did back in January. So thank you. Thank you, all of you, for coming up. It really means a lot to me that you're here to see this and be with me to experience it. So with that, I'm just going to make sure I adjust to your property. My name is Trent Hunter, and I live in the Coburg area with my wife, Kathleen. I'm not from these parts. I'm from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, born and raised out there. And this month is going on 53 years now, so I'm 53 years of age. I'm going to share my story, and I look forward to this because it really is like what you've already heard. It's a simple story from an average guy, but if by doing this one day, that message will touch someone's heart or resonate with them, because I know the stories I've heard, every story I've heard today, there's similarities to my life. There's things that I have felt have touched me, and one of the biggest things I've learned, and I'd like to pass on to people by sharing my story, is maybe you can realize that you're not alone in your struggles in life, if nothing else. Maybe it's going to be something that makes you feel better about yourself, and hopefully one day it brings someone to the Lord, because that really is what this is all about. That's what this means to me today. So thank you, and just bear with me for a few minutes, and I'll share my story. So, born and raised in Saskatoon, not religious, sorry, I want to use that word, didn't have a lot of faith growing up. My father was an atheist, as best I know, his entire life, so I didn't have any exposure there. My mother, although she did have some faith as a youngster, her mom and dad, my grandparents, were very faithful, going to church all the time on the weekends. I didn't have a lot of it growing up. Yes, we grew up with O Canada in school. We grew up with the Lord's Prayer at school. I can remember on my knees saying my nightly prayers at night beside the bed that my mom enforced for the longest time as well. And I can still recite what my grandfather would say for grace after every meal. So very little exposure. But my parents divorced at the age of eight, my age of eight. And from there, the life's pressures, mostly on my mom, is kind of what caved in on our faith. That was one of the first things, unfortunately, to go by the wayside. I took on an adult role in the family, being the older of two brothers. So by doing that, just, you know, household chores, a big one for me was the involvement in sports. My brother and I both played hockey and baseball, and I swam and all those kinds of things. Well, that just occupies a lot of time. So like I said, unfortunately, faith went by the wayside. At a very young age, I learned to become fiercely independent. I think we heard that earlier today. As the older of two boys in the house, I took on that male role model. I took on the responsibility for cutting the grass, for doing everything that a man would do. And at 8 years old, that's a tough age. It's a very tough age to do that. But it was the start of my independence. And in my mind, I'm one of the more independent people I know. But I know, again, there's other people out there that are in the same situation. And that's one of the things that can serve you well. But when you block out everything else around you, emotions, etc., well, then independence doesn't necessarily serve you that well. So I created an independent man as a teenager. So by the ripe age of about 12 or 13 years old, I was firmly believing that there was nobody going to look after my happiness but me. I was the only one responsible for that. So look out, everybody, because I'm going to take charge of my life. I relied on anything I could get to satisfy a happiness. I didn't ever have inner joy that a couple weeks ago Pastor Dave spoke about inner joy and where that truly comes from. I've never experienced that. At a young age, fantasy became a big one, right? Whether it was from watching movies or watching TV shows or reading books, you kind of get lost. Your brain gets lost in a better life, in a better world, in one that wasn't so stressful, one that wasn't burdened with all those pressures of being the older of two children in a family that needed that leadership. Overachiever and perfectionism became two of my mechanisms as well. I believe that was probably to seek affirmation, likely from my father. My father I did see, but I saw him about 12 hours, maybe 11 hours a week, every Saturday, and that was it. That was the only really influence he had in my life. He was an alcoholic. I went on to become one. I became like my father. But it was that overachieving and perfectionism that I believe was striving to get that affirmation from people, probably my father. I also became a fixer. I'm very mechanically oriented. I like to, I wrench with cars. I've rebuilt cars my entire life from high school onwards. I love that kind of stuff, and I'm also a scientist. So I became this fixer, this person who liked to take broken things and fix them. And I can relate that to, not relationships per se, but other people's problems. For example, when my kids had a problem, I would try to fix that problem, right? And sometimes you can't. Sometimes you can put money on that. Sometimes you can take them to work because they don't have a way to get to work. But when it comes to the emotional problems, you can't fix that. I'll get back to that in a few seconds. The one thing I did forget to talk about here, and as Pastor Glenn mentioned, I was an infant Baptist man. 7 months old, I was baptized. So I like the fact that you've led into that, because I'm going to talk to that near the end, but there's a very important difference to me from then until now that is, again, the reason I'm standing here with you. Productivity became another big one as well. Unfortunately, even to this day, I still measure my success by productivity, how much work I can get done in a day or a week or a weekend. I get my chores outlined for the weekend. If I don't get them done, boy, I'm not going to be a grumpy person, right? So, and then as you get older and as you mature, more things become available to satisfy that inner need, to satisfy that short-term happiness. Whether it be, alcohol and drugs are both being referred to here. The interest in girls, when you become a teenager, and sexual maturity, of course, now you're starting to chase after girls because it's that affirmation, that affection, maybe even love in some cases, you're looking for that. But the truth of the matter was I was terrified, because what I haven't mentioned yet is I also withdrew emotionally. Emotionally, I started building walls around me as a kid, as a very young kid, because I believe my parents hurt me as when they got divorced, right? I didn't know this, but I started to shield myself from, okay, if people close to me are going to hurt me, then I'm not going to let people close to me, and I started building all these walls. So now, I talked about maturity. Well, yes, what comes with that is not just sexual maturity, but now you get a job, now you have the ability to purchase alcohol and purchase drugs and drive your car and be out partying and be out. I mean, I'm going to admit to the fact that as a teenager, I did steal things, because there was a high that came. At 21 years old, I had an impaired driving charge under my belt. You know, I was well on my way to a path of destruction. Again, something else I'm going to refer to in a few minutes here. The other thing about the emotional part is I was left out of kids' events. What do I mean by that? For example, on a swimming team, when you're in a group of small kids, 10, 12 years old, and you know 8 or 10 of them are going over to so-and-so's house afterwards, but you're not invited, that hurts you emotionally. And I've only come to realize now, and even at the time I believe I knew, that it wasn't me that was necessarily being discriminated against. It was my mother, because she was a single parent. And back then, and now, there was always divorced parents back in that time and now, but it just seemed that the community I was in, it wasn't really accepted. So you wear that as a kid, and you feel it as a kid, and you just don't have have that acceptance. And what that did for me is it took away all my self-esteem, all my self-confidence, because you're just not included, right? You get teased. I made the mistake of being, I was a competitive swimmer as a youngster, but I wanted to do what my friends were doing, which is play hockey. So I got into hockey. I convinced my parents to put me into hockey. Well, what happened there was I had missed the first 6 years of learning how to skate, so now I'm out on the ice being more embarrassed and even lower self-esteem and lower self-confidence when you know all the kids around you are talking about these things, right? So I carry those things into adulthood. And the other thing I haven't mentioned is the impact of a lot of these things is you build inner anger. Anger, resentment, the walls I've talked about, and those, as you get older and become more mature and you become a man, not just a boy, well, they become incredibly powerful, and they become things that alienate you from other people around you, because now an angry man is not a fun thing to be around, right? So those are all the kinds of things I've experienced. Self-confidence, self-esteem. I struggled with relationships. I really did. I wanted to have a girlfriend, but I was terrified because I didn't see a functioning relationship growing up between a husband and wife or my mother and father. So although I wanted that, I didn't know how to get that. I was scared of that, scared of that attention, therefore I avoided it. I always found an excuse. So again, as a man growing up, that's a self-confidence thing that just gets eroded and eroded and eroded away. So the walls just got thicker and bigger and bigger. And eventually, at the ripe age, like I say, I was 21 years old, I ran away from home. When I say I ran away from home, I finished university, I packed up, and I moved to Saskatchewan. I moved out to Ontario to pursue a job. I didn't look at the time as running away from home, but that's what I was doing. I was leaving behind all my friends, all my family. I didn't need them. I didn't need God. I had left him behind back when I was, five or six years old. I didn't need friends. I didn't need family. I thought I had, life by the coattails. I thought I was on my way to a happy and prosperous life. But it just got worse. For me, that was my experience. It just got worse. You stay in your resentment. You stay in your anger. You don't have friends. I have work acquaintances over all those time periods, but the work acquaintances were people that I gravitated to, right? People of similar interests. Well, similar interests at that time without God in my life was other sinners, was other ungodly people that I fit in great with. Partying all the time. I told you I had an impaired driving charge at the age of 21. Thankfully, and I do have some good in the story here, because I have had many successes. I had a 23-year career in the Air Force as a pilot in the Air Force. But it was now, and I won't get into this one too deep, but it was a pilot I flew with that had been saved that pointed me in the direction of a recruiting center. And that didn't even click to me until years and years later, because the military gave me structure, gave me the ability to stay within some confines and probably kept me out of jail or worse addictions that I ended up with, because you can't do certain things within the military, right? Alcohol's accepted? Well, bring it on. Let's go with that. So yes, I've had many, many, many successes in my life. Air Force career for 23 years, I was married. And now what I was doing is starting to go through the little checklist, right? Of all the boxes I thought that was deemed appropriate and necessary for you in society to grow up as a functioning human being. So yeah, I got married. I had two wonderful children, one of which is with me here today. The friendships I developed, like I said, were shallow. But along the way, I also had some mishaps, right? I had an impaired driving charge. I had a divorce as well. Addictions, had a car accident with carelessness that could have taken the life of my son, and that was a year before I decided it was time for me to go to addictions and a treatment facility for alcoholism. So I had many stumbles along the way, and it was by the grace of God that I'm even still here talking and able to talk to you, and I was able to get saved. But at 53 years old is when I was finally saved. That's kind of the background, that's where I found myself. I've often described to people that my entire life, it's almost like an anxiety. I almost felt like I was trying to get somewhere all the time, right? Trying to get through elementary school, get to high school, okay, finish high school, let's go to university, that's the next thing to do. That's what society wants. From high school there, okay, let's get married, right, have a family, have some kids, I needed a career, I'm just checking all the boxes as I go, but never really enjoying it along the way. I also, when I mentioned I was a fixer, I came across some problems later in life. Addiction was one of them, but when close family members suffer from mental disorders, whether it be depression, anxiety, my mother is in a home now with Alzheimer's, when I can't fix that becomes a problem, right? And then the biggest problem of all was me. When I determined that I couldn't fix me, then you're kind of lost, and then I didn't know where to turn. So I was still along the way doing all these things that brought me the short-term happiness or this, the short-term joy, but it wasn't joy. So that's kind of the background I have. I didn't do any federal time, only again by the grace of God. So I could have ended up in jail, but I didn't. But it was back in October of last year, and I can't really describe to you what happened, but that was what I consider, and that's why I made the mention of God pulling you in, because for whatever reason, back in October of last year, when my life, I guess, is maybe becoming overwhelming, I don't remember it being that way, but yeah, things are mentally starting to wear me down, I opened the door, I unlocked the door, and God opened that door, and let me tell you, I can honestly say that when He decides to draw you in, you can't refuse that. You just cannot do that because He is that powerful. So in October, and the way I'm going to kind of describe how it's affected me and changes I'm going to give you, I like to look at it as this. He put things in my way. I think we heard earlier today, maybe it was at the sermon today, but there's always choices. God always gives you choices in life, and that is exactly what I can describe my experience. He hasn't come and had a personal conversation that I could recite the words to with me. I pray all the time. And sometimes halfway through my prayer, I have my own answer because He's put it in my thoughts. But that's how I'm going to go about this, because there's several little things now that I think are important that have taken place. So the first one is my wife, Kathleen. She came to me one day and she told me about, it was a YouTube video she had watched about a near-death experience. And that was the seed that was put in my ear. Now, I'm a stubborn person too. That's another trait I have. Not only angry and frustrated and addictions, but I get stubborn too. So she mentioned this to me. I listened to her. It was a couple days later, and I watched the video, and wow, the video was great. Don't get me wrong, the video was great, and his experience was fantastic, but what really struck me was his description. This individual was describing when he had died, the people that were escorting him to hell, because he described me. He described everything about the lifestyle I was leading, the people I hung around with, and even more powerful than that to me was the visual I got, because in this video, he showed this dead landscape of just trees blowing in the wind, gray sky, windy, blustery kind of conditions. Well, every day when I drive home, that's what I see exiting the 401 in October. There's no leaves in the trees, so I'm looking at gray sky, the steely color of Lake Ontario, the trees with no leaves, no life, and I'm reflecting upon this, and I'm thinking, well, there's got to be more to life than this. There's got to be way more. When I went to addictions, I'm going to back up a little bit. When I went to my addictions counseling, I had all the pieces there except God. I believed in a higher power. I believed there was a God, but I didn't have faith, and He wasn't in my life, so I might as well not. So that was probably the first thing that happened, because he was describing self-righteous people, selfish people, you know, not obnoxious people, but not happy people, angry people. So that kind of started me down that path of the thoughts. And then a couple weeks later, and I can't remember when it was exactly, but I was out jogging. I was at work one day at lunchtime. I had music playing in my ears. For whatever reason, again, this is where I put the power of God into play, is I stopped my music and started to pray. And it's because in the video, the individual had spoken about when he was being escorted to hell, he couldn't remember a prayer. He couldn't remember how to pray, what to say. He pulled something out of thin air, and then the light appeared and Jesus saved him. So I thought to myself, I'm going to start to pray, but I didn't know how to pray. And thank goodness I was out by myself, because I'm a perfectionist, right? And if I can't pray properly, and I've heard some very good people who have prayed for me, and I listen to Pastor Glenn every week and Pastor Dave make their prayers. So if I can't do what they do, then I feel embarrassed. I feel anxious. So I just did it on my own. And the next biggest thing that happened to me was just a flood of emotions. So there it was. I struggled to see. I got reading glasses. I got another pair of glasses. I got two pair of glasses I have to wear. So here I am out jogging, no glasses, eyes full of tears streaming down my face. No idea really where I was going, but it felt good. And that's how I want to describe that, is the emotions that were released. It was like, Brian, I think you mentioned it earlier. It was like a giant weight lifted off my shoulder. It just really was a relief. And that was the beginning of it. And I do that quite regularly now. Of course, I pray on my own in quiet time too, so he can have a chance to speak back to me. But that's become something of mine. So that's the second thing that kind of took place in my life. And then, back in about December or January, a good friend of my wife's family was in correspondence with Kathleen, and she was talking about a course, and it's put on by Journey Canada, and it's a ministry that puts on a discipleship course. So, in the email, and I have this written down, the quotation was, "Your husband might also want to consider it."
bunch of stuff to Kathleen in that one phrase. So again, he put this in my path, and I had a choice to make. And at the time, I'll be honest here, I had to Google, and I didn't do it then. It's probably a good thing I didn't. A week or so later, before I actually started this course, I had to Google what a disciple was. I had to Google what discipleship meant, because I had no idea, right? I had started to try to read the Bible. I couldn't get past the first three sentences in the book of John because of the way it's written. And I just thought, okay, that's not for me. I don't understand that. So here I was now signing up for a discipleship course. I did that at the time, really, because I looked at the length of the course and the amount of commitment it was. And I figured, well, I don't know if Kathleen would stick to that by herself. It's a lot of work, a lot of effort. So maybe it'd be better if we both did it at the same time. So I said, sure, I'll do it. One of the biggest life-changing events I've experienced, it really was. And Jeff, who's here tonight as a guest of mine, he was a team leader on that, and it was a fantastic experience. It really was, and it was just the next step for me. It showed me things about me. It educated me. A lot of the things I've just talked about, I didn't really understand or know about me, right? It took me through me, how I became me, and then how to develop that relationship with Jesus. So that was a fantastic, fantastic experience. Along the way there, I also developed this insatiable appetite for the Word. So yeah, I couldn't understand the first three sentences of the book of John, but now I can't get enough of it. It consumes me. It really does. Now, I have an addictive personality, so I can stand here and speak about that, and those that know me know that I'll say the same thing about exercise, and I'll say the same thing probably about drinking when I was drinking. But in a good way, reading God's Word satisfies. It's filling that. I'm going to steal this phrase from a song, at least. Maybe it's in the Bible as well. But He's calming the storm within me. So when there's something that I have experienced that can fix my inner anger, start to fix my inner anger, because I am not perfect and I'm still walking this path. But it just feels good, you know, when I read that and I understand that. I'm going to jump ahead to another point, because one of the things that very quickly happened here after, when I started coming to the church, I was very, very rapidly invited to a men's Bible study group. Brian and Sean are both part of that. Keith is part of that. I'm not sure if Chad is online, but there's some fantastic people that I have been exposed to and involved with that took me into their lives, because they accepted me for who I was. And that's a really fantastic feeling that I can only just try to describe it to people in hopes that they'll understand that. What else has happened? The inner calming of my anger has certainly been a big one. The church itself. I mean, coming to Evangel Church, we drove in one day. So for Journey, our discipleship course ended. The spring was coming. So the next step was to find a church, somewhere to go where we would be welcomed. This was our first stop, and this is our only stop. We came in one day, and it was, again, Brian, I'm going to refer to you, because the first person we met was driving the parking lot. You were the one that introduced us, and again, to me, that was a choice, and I've told Brian this. I had a choice to warm up and be as friendly back as he was to me, or we could have just said, hi, how are you, gone and parked and sat in our truck and just kind of did our own thing, but we didn't. And the welcome that we have received, and I know that I have not met everybody in the congregation, but the people, we have not met anybody that's been short of fantastic, welcoming, real, caring people. And I can't say enough about that. And for those who have known me in the past, I'm an isolator. There's a reason I only have five people here, well, partly because my family is all west here in Alberta now. But I don't necessarily gravitate towards building long-term friendships. I have work acquaintances, and then I am isolated. I liken my journey to taking myself up to the high Arctic, where I'm alone, and nobody can bug me, nobody can interfere with my life, and that's not a happy place. So God's turned me around, and he's making me march back down that path. And while I do that, he's educating me, and he's bringing these fantastic people and experiences into my life. So today, I'm happily married to my wife, Kathleen. We moved through life one day at a time in the grace of God. I can't say that enough. It's only by His grace that we're even able to move on through our life. I still struggle with turmoil every day, and that's something that I'm going to be working on every day, but now I'm not alone. I never was. I just didn't accept Him before. Okay, so earlier I mentioned my baptism as an infant. 7 months old. I looked at my certificate today. I was 7 months old. What I can honestly say now, too, knowing what is going to take place here is God has always been wanting me to be with him. He's pursued me, just like he's pursuing every person on the planet, really. It's whether or not we choose to walk that path with him. His love for us is that powerful that he will not ever give up. And that is something that I'm going to be doing my baptism for today, because I could never repay the price he paid, by having his son sacrificed on the cross. But what I can do is honor him, I can worship him, I can appreciate and love him, and I can walk the path of Jesus, really, because that is what it comes down to for me, is Jesus came down to do that for us and is no longer with us, and that's all he's asking us really to do, is be good people and walk in the path. So with that, I do want to mention one more thing. I took the easy path in life before, and I want to share just a quote. I'm going to read this because I want to get it right. It's a very powerful one for me. It's Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. And it's, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." And I can stand in front of all of you and God now and say that I've probably found the way to the narrow gate. It's up to me now to follow that path. And I have one short prayer that I'm going to say as well before we move on. And that's, Heavenly Father, having heard the gospel, received and believed your word, I stand now before you in your presence, in the presence of all of our guests here today, in your grace to be baptized. I pray that you deem me worthy of this recognition and will bless me by filling with your Holy Spirit, so that I may follow in the path of your Son, my Savior, and my King, Jesus Christ. And in his name, amen. Thank you.
Pastor Steve, you're going to come and baptize Sean. And I just want to say thank you for being patient with us. We know you have a long distance to drive, some of you to get back. We don't want you to leave. If you have to leave right away, there is food. We don't want you to go. If you can't stay, grab some food. Go through the nursery, which is the door just out here, through the little Sunday school room. There's a room full of food there. 25 people can sit and eat there. Others can come and sit on these picnic tables out here, the harvest tables, and you can sit around those tables there or stand around. I know I'm missing something. Outside, if you want. That's it. To comply, the servers will serve the food. So they will be all around there to help put the food on the table. All right.
Yes, move some of those mics because I know some of you are here to view this. I don't really need that. You can move it. With my voice, I was a teacher for 27 years, so. I still move that this way, because those people can't see. I'm looking down this way, and it's his family that wants to see. Well, folks, a couple, 3 weeks ago, I got a text or phone call from Sean. I was in Alberta visiting my grandson. And he said, "I'm getting baptized on Saturday. Can you do it?" Well, I was coming home on Friday. I had a wedding at 4 o'clock, and I said, at 12 o'clock, let's do it, and I'll try not to break the speed limit and get back to for the wedding. The next thing I know, it's not happening. It's going to happen today. So he asked me again, and I want to thank Pastor Glenn for the opportunity of being able to do this. It's a privilege, Sean, that you would call me to do it, and I tell you what we're going to do. He's a big man, so I'll get him up sometime, okay? If it gets dark, you'll come and help me, okay? But I want to let you know that I'm going to baptize him. I'm going to put him under the water. We're going to bury the old Sean. That's somewhere. It's already happened, but we're just letting you know that this is what he's chosen to do. He's going to be buried, letting the world know that he's buried that old Sean. And he's going to come up. Just like Jesus came up out of the grave, he's going to come up a new creature.
Yeah.
And tell me the privilege. I'm a little bit emotional sometimes, not too often. But I tell me the privilege to. to be able to do this. So we're going to step back because we're up on some blocks here now. You will hear my voice. So Sean, I'm trying to get, I don't want you to go up there. Can you go to your left? Okay. Upon the public confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your desire to follow him all your life, I baptize you, brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You ready?
I'm all set.
All right.
You Pretty fitting for me.
I'd like to thank everyone for coming. It's a real pleasure. Thank you, Pastor Glenn, Pastor Steve. What an honor. First off, I'd just like to say, before I start blowing my head off already, I love my family. They've stuck by me this whole time. And, you know, thank you for all my friends for coming for the slice. It's real good for everybody to get together. And right now, especially under this, the new me is totally, it's almost unbelievable how I can feel. You can't even explain it, but you have to be inside my body to get it. Like, hopefully it starts showing on the outside, because it's just love that I feel instead of the hate that I used to feel. That's it. I come from a big family. I'm the baby out of the 16 of us. But, you know, I've seen so much drinking and drugging going on, I didn't think I wanted any of it. But, of course, I got my taste of it, and I ran with it. But I didn't do very good with it because it got the best of me. And next thing you know, what did it do? It landed me in prison, not once, but multiple times. Like, I mean, for 9 years sickness at a time. And even in there, I took it even to another extreme and ended up going to the hole and almost losing my mind in there. It's just the devil working on me, that's all it was. But I would never get that at the time. So then I get out of prison, what did I think was the best thing to do? Was join a bike club. So of course, again, I had to go for the biggest and baddest and join the Hells Angels. And I'm not saying any of this stuff to be proud of or nothing else. I'm actually a little bit, where I'm looking for, not disappointed, but I'm a little embarrassed about it, but you know, it is my story, so that's part of it. The best part is, it's in the past. Yeah. And you know, so when I became the Hells Angels, thinking of traveling the world, thinking it was all that, but I still wasn't happy. No matter what I did, traveling the world, partying all over, I still wasn't happy. Exactly like Adam said, there was that hole there that you had to fill. The perfect name, Adam, is the God hole. Because now it's filled and I'm happy. You know, do I still got a long way to go? Sure. But I'm learning every day because that Bible is my book. And every place I go, it's with me. And now, it's, you know, it's the one night it happened. It was just anxiety, you know. I could go on to the horror stories of being shot at and doing all the drugs, but a lot of people have been there and done that, so that's not even the important part. The important part is I got saved from that. Yeah. I asked for my life. I got what I need from my last four, and it was that night that happened. The Holy Ghost came into my heart, and I haven't been the same since. Yeah. I, you know, living in fear was all I was doing. I went out the next night, looking up at the sky, and said, God, the fear is gone. And that's exactly how fast it happened, just like that. And, you know, ever since then, just learning more about the Bible is just so enriching. And you can live your life by reading that Bible and doing the good things. You know what I mean? Everything's since has been so good. I'm just so happy to be here. I love you, Brother Brian. Sister-in-law Mary, thank you, people. God bless us.
Pastor, if you could just come up and ask a blessing, please.
Lord, we're thankful. We live in a land of plenty. We have a lot of problems here, we do, but God, we're blessed, and I just pray that you would bless us with this food. We're thankful for it. Bless us on our travel home. Keep us safe. Lord, I pray these testimonies shared here tonight, Lord, will not just quickly be forgotten, but God will think about it. If we're here and we don't have that same faith that these men have shared, I pray that you would speak to us in our dreams through these testimonies, whatever it takes, Lord God. There's a better way. There's a better life. Lord, you are a chain breaker, and I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.